listen to radio. iLive Radio.
We've got Chris Duff, who is the founder of Inspired Initiatives. Yes, hi, Chris. Yes, welcome to the show.
Yes, thank you very much for having me, man.
We've been having quite a you know, I think we should probably start the show like an hour earlier when I'm having my conversations.
Yeah, those candid prep.
Yeah, the candid conversations. But we've been having a good time just talking about what exactly is your organization? What do you do? You work with youth, work with corporations, you work with school boards, you smack people around or something.
Most definitely.
you can start off by letting everybody know exactly what is.
Yeah, for sure. So I like to kind of break it down into two, I guess, dimensions.
Yes.
So on one end, what we do for organizations, and then on the other end, what we do for the community.
Okay.
So for the organizations, we're an innovation consulting firm, and we work with organizations to help them get better results from their programs and services. As I'm sure you probably know, within the social sector, metrics, benchmarks, outputs, that's like currency, right?
Yeah.
So we help them to use innovation-based principles to actually get better, let's say, increasing their enrollment or increasing their retention or increasing the engagement in the overall programs.
Mm-hmm.
So we offer three services, one of them being consulting. We offer training, and then we also offer facilitation.
Okay.
Now, on the community side of things, where my heart is, for the community, what we do is we actually help them. We level the playing field for the marginalized communities by helping these organizations better reach the needs of the communities.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, typically what happens is when an organization's getting ready to design a program or a service, they look at three things. One, what are we funded to do? Second thing is, what are we able to do in terms of capacity and resources? And then third thing is, what do we assume that the community needs? And so what we often see in the field is that they often miss the mark, right? Mm-hmm. They often miss the mark of the actual needs. And so
hang on one second here.
Let's get into it.
You said what they assume
that target
community needs. So, like, what does that mean? Is it somebody gets up and says, oh, I think, this particular community needs more gyms? How do they come to that?
So there's a couple ways. So one of them is that they only look at numbers, right? So mm-hmm. people are sitting in a boardroom and they say to themselves, well, we see that there's a high unemployment rate. We'll use that as an example,
okay.
Right? So let's say the government or whoever it is goes on TV or press conference or whatever the case might be, and they say, the unemployment rate for young people is 29%.
Yeah.
Just throwing that number out there. But the challenge with that is that they're not looking at the context. Right, they're not looking at the actual context. So what's going on behind that number?
Okay.
So they look at that data and they say, well, we're going to assume that if the unemployment rate is 29%, then that means that they need employment training. Right?
Okay. Yeah.
There's an assumption there.
Because in order to get the job, you need some training. Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So, but where they miss the mark now is that when you go into some of these communities, and I'm just talking about a few communities.
Yeah.
When you go into some of these communities and you talk to some of the young people, some of them don't want to get a regular job, not because they can't, but because they can make more money on the streets than they can make at a McDonald's, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, I was talking to one young person, and they're making like $1,000 a week on the streets. And I'm not saying that for you to go out there and start doing that, but it's an example of...
I need to change my job. What's this young guy doing on the street?
So my thing is, like, when we say these things and we come up with these solutions, we're assuming that's the solution instead of understanding, okay, well, what's the actual need, right, mm-hmm. in some of these contexts? And then, I mean, even with that now, so what's happening, especially with the employment field, what's now happening is that you have a lot of employment training, but the employment training that's happening is not preparing them for the new face of the workforce, right? So it's still stuck in the old face of the workforce, where it's just only resumes and, what do you do in an interview? What do you wear? Work ethic and all these things that... all these things that employers wanted in the past, but now a lot of new companies are coming up that require 21st century skills.
Mm-hmm.
So things like collaboration, critical thinking, creativity, problem solving,
mm-hmm.
All that stuff. And so we're not preparing them for that workforce, right?
Okay.
That's just one example. But again, we're missing the mark in terms of these assumptions that we have.
Okay, so I don't want to belabor this point a little bit, but well, maybe just for a little bit.
Let's do it.
So what do you tell to, you know, a young person that comes in and says, you know what, okay, so I got my, you know, this program helped me to get my resume together, and, you know, I'm being offered this job at McDonald's, but, you know, I can make $1,000 a week on the streets doing what I'm, you know, doing my hustling.
Yeah.
You know, how, what do you say to a kid like that to, like, what do you do?
Yeah.
Because the what's real to them?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They're looking at, okay, so I'm going to be working at McDonald's for 8 hours
yeah.
a day, making minimum wage, which is not going to be close to what I can make otherwise.
Yeah.
So how do you change that mindset?
So it's about values and priorities as well, right? So the reason why they're out there making that money, I mean, doing that is because they value money in that respect.
Yeah.
So they think that the more money I get is the more powerful I'm going to be, or the more money I get is the less problems I have, or whatever the case might be. So even exposing them to the legitimacy of actually having a job. So for example, I'm watching a show right now called Queen of the South, right?
Yeah.
And it's have you watched that?
Yes.
You kind of dabbled a little bit.
Yeah. Yes. That's.
So it's a very interesting show because I mean it shows the life of the main actress, she's kind of involved in that life of crime, but it's like she's always having to look over her shoulder, right? Always living in that state of, I don't know what's going to happen next. I don't know if I'm going to get caught.
State of fear.
That's it. That's it, right? So it's almost like you kind of present that to them and then try to show them a different perspective on things. Expose them to different jobs. I mean, a lot of young people that I speak to, they don't even know about investments. They don't know about stock market. They don't know about real estate investments, right? Where you can be making double what you're making on the streets if you do it legitimately and you do it properly, right? So there's other avenues. It's just that they're not exposed to that. So this is what I grew up knowing. My brother was doing this. My cousin was doing this. My dad was doing this. So this is what I get into.
Okay. So
I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry. you started it, man.
Well, yeah, you know, a lot of people, it's hard to change that mindset. Absolutely. Because in our society today, everything is about, you know, I want it now. It's a quick fix. It's, you know, I got to have it right now.
Right.
And so to tell a young person, okay, you need to slow down a little bit.
Right.
You know, it's you're not going to be discovered overnight and be the superstar the next day. But you got to pay your dues.
Yeah.
And this is what paying your dues looks like.
Right.
That can be a big challenge when our society is very about instant gratification.
For sure.
You know, you want a meal, you go to a restaurant, you want it 5 minutes ago.
Right.
You don't want to necessarily sit and wait for them to make it.
Right.
You know, it should be made ready waiting for you. So
I agree.
You know, with you know, being able to tackle that mindset and help kids to understand that sometimes you gotta take some steps in order to get there.
Yeah.
That's huge.
It is. And it doesn't happen overnight. You know, just like their mindset currently didn't happen overnight. Mm-hmm. So it does take time to kind of get out there and constantly kind of bring them under your wing and kind of show them the ropes. And it's actually interesting because sometimes when I go in because I work in a lot of marginalized communities, so sometimes when I go in there, I go in with, you know, a blazer and a dress shirt and all that kind of stuff. And a lot of them will come up to me and be like, sir, you know, what are you up to? What do you do?
Yeah.
You know, 'cause they don't see that often. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So when I'm going into schools, I remember there was this one young guy that said to me, you know, the main reason why I wanted to come in and sit on your session, but because I don't often see a young black man coming into the school in a suit.
Okay.
And I mean, like, just stuff like that exposure, you know what I mean? And it seems so simple, but again, to some people, it means the world.
Well, okay, so a lot of people are on the flip side of that are saying, oh, come on, it's 2016. Right. Like, you know, is this really still a problem? Like, why is this something that we even need any kind of a program towards? Like, you know, we've moved on. Like, get over it already.
Right. So I know it's funny, and it's actually interesting that you bring that up. And I would actually bring the counter argument of, so then why do we have programs for women? Why do we need to empower women?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Why is it that we need to have these things that are exclusively for women only? Why do we need to have I think it was Trudeau that said, I need to have a cabinet that has 50% women. Like, why, if it's 2016, why do we need to still do that?
Mm-hmm.
The reality is that there are some people who are still marginalized in our communities, right? And we can't deny that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I mean, it could be 2016 and you can see women on the TV, you can see women on a woman running for president, but yeah, we still need to make those institutional changes at the systematic level, right?
Okay, so you use the word a few times so far, and maybe you can break it down for listeners. Yep. When you say marginalized communities, what exactly does that mean in our society today?
Yeah, so basically what it means is you have people who are not at the same level in terms of playing field. So for example, I saw a great photo actually. So it was of a dad. So it was three people looking over a fence.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so it was a dad who was tall enough to be able to look over the fence with no problem. Mm-hmm. Then there was a child who was a little shorter than him who had a smaller stool.
Yeah.
And then there was a baby who needed a larger stool.
Yeah.
Right. So there's some people in our communities that are kind of set in a really I'll call it a disadvantaged space. Mm-hmm. Right. And so they might need that extra boost or they might need that extra support. Mm-hmm. And so it doesn't necessarily have to be only a black community. It can be newcomers. So when a newcomer comes over to Canada, they can be marginalized because they don't have the same kind of support to be able to get them on that same level or playing field as somebody who might have been born here. Mm-hmm. Right. So we're looking at somebody who might have been at a disadvantaged space.
I know the imagery that you're talking about. I've seen it, and I'm sure lots of people have seen it. Mm-hmm. But then the counter argument could be, you know, well, if everybody has, you know, the sidewalk's hard, everybody's got to walk on that.
Yeah.
Wherever it takes you, it's up to you.
Right.
You know, why is it that someone else needs more than the other person? Like, how is that fair?
Right.
Because somebody may be looking at it and say, well, you know, I'm not getting the same advantages of this other person's getting. Right. Well, right. How is that fair to me? Right. When I would want to get those advantages too.
Right. Yeah. And but it's not to say that you're not going to get those advantages. It's just that there's some communities that need a little more investment than others. Right. So, I mean, I'll give you an example. So, for instance, there was a community over in Woodstock. I'm not sure if you heard about it, but their young people had like no real programs or no real outlet. And so what they often did was they started doing things with crime, they started committing suicide, they started getting into drugs because they need some type of outlet, right? Mm-hmm. And so anybody can say to themselves that, you know, I'm disadvantaged or I need this too. But I mean, the reality is there's some communities that need a little more support. Mm-hmm. Right. And that's what we're looking at. So it's not a matter of we're trying to discriminate or tell you that, oh, you know, well, you don't count. It's just that, again, the reality is that there's some communities that might not have as much resources as others. And so we need to pump a little more resources, and that's not necessarily just financial. That can be just generally programs. That could be support. That could be mentors. They just need a little more support than other communities do. And again, we're not saying that you as an individual might not need that, but mm-hmm. maybe the community that you're living in doesn't necessarily need that kind of investment, right?
Okay, so my apologies because I kind of cut you off when you were, you know, giving your spiel about. No,
you got me started, man. You got me started.
You were talking about your organization and what exactly it is that you
do. Yeah, let's go back to that.
Maybe you can finish that off for us because I kind of cut you off midstream there. Okay, so you deal with other organizations and you help develop programs for them.
Yes.
So what does that look like? So if, you know, I'm an organization and I come to you or you come to me and now we're sitting in this meeting and you talked about where I cut you off really was about programs that people kind of think that community needs versus what the community needs.
Yes, yes.
So, you know, how do you tackle that?
So a couple ways, actually. One of them being through empathy research. So when we look at the idea of empathy, it's about how can I put myself in another person's shoes? Mm-hmm. So for example, if I'm walking down the street and I see a homeless person, right? Sympathy will tell me or sympathy will say to me, I feel bad for this person.
Yeah.
I feel really sorry for this person. I don't know what it is you're going through, but you know, I feel bad. And that might motivate me to want to give them money or give them food or whatever the case is. Mm-hmm. But what empathy will speak to is this idea of, if I was sitting in your shoes or if I was where you are, what would I be thinking and feeling right now? Mm-hmm. What would I be saying and doing? What would I be hearing? What would I be seeing? So the idea is that when we use empathy research, we go out into the community and we talk to people and mm-hmm. we engage with them and we sit down with them over coffee or wherever they are and we have a conversation with them, right? And we also observe them. And then in some cases, we actually experience what they're experiencing. Mm-hmm. So for example, we had an opportunity to, we were working with a youth shelter and we had an opportunity to actually spend time in that youth shelter to experience what it is that they're experiencing, immersing ourselves into that context. Because there's no better way to gather that kind of data than actually going through it, right? So that's what we do. I mean, so if an organization is looking to design a program, we'll guide them in that process. How do they identify what the actual needs are? Mm-hmm. How do they identify what the unarticulated needs are? Because mm-hmm. people can tell you things all they want, but the reality is sometimes they don't know what they need, right? Henry Ford had said, if I asked people what they wanted, he's the one that created the car.
Yeah.
And he said, if I asked people what they wanted, they would have told me faster horses.
Yeah.
That's what he said, right?
That's true.
You know what I'm saying? So sometimes we can't see beyond what we know. So again, we help organizations to identify those unarticulated needs and then use those as the basis for their program.
I'm thinking about the unarticulated needs.
Yes.
How in the world do you figure that out with people? Now, you know, personal level, yeah. You know, corporate wise, yeah. All around, that's big. That's mm-hmm. hard. Because
yeah,
you're right. A lot of people, they don't exactly know exactly what they need.
No, absolutely.
And so to be able to go walk into an environment like that, or whether it's the forms that you use, like town halls or community meetings, mm-hmm. things like that, mm-hmm. to be able to get them, how do you sift through that?
So again, it is the process of empathy, and you'd be surprised what you can gather from people from observation. Mm-hmm. So I'll give you an example of that. So we just, was it yesterday? Yeah, yesterday, we're working with the Toronto Youth Cabinet. Right, mm-hmm. So that's like Toronto's kind of advisory board for young people.
Yes.
And they kind of advise the city council on youth issues. So we're working with them through the whole process of design thinking. And what we do with that one, we're working actually on designing a solution to help the TTC to increase the ridership.
Okay.
So what we did was...
Lower the fares.
What's that?
Lower the fares. Increase service.
I know, right? But so what we did was we actually...
fix the subways so they work.
I know, right? Seriously.
But I'm sorry, it's a short spot for me because I you know, I'm working downtown and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna, you know what? Most convenient way is to take the TTC.
Right.
Drive to the subway station, right. I get on the train, I go three stops in, we stop. We're sitting there for 45 minutes.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, oh, you know what? It's just an off day. Mm-hmm. You know? Back on the train the next day, same thing happens again.
Yeah.
Day three, same thing happened again. I said, you know what? To hell with this. I'm just going to drive.
Absolutely.
Pay for parking. Parking's a little expensive, mm-hmm. but you know what? At least I know I'm going to be able to get through.
No, absolutely.
Anyways, yeah. I'm going off on a tangent
No,
here,
it's true, man. And those short turns? No, TTC. And those short turns, they're annoying, man. No, I agree.
Yeah, you got to. What is up with. Anyways. All right,
No, I hear you. But yeah, so I definitely understand your complaints, man. So, but the idea was that we took them out. And so we had a presentation where they were kind of talking about the numbers side of things,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So they broke down all the numbers to us. So, I mean, in terms of the delays, the short turns, all these different metrics that they use to measure.
Piss people off.
Right, exactly. Yes. But what we did was we put a context behind those numbers. So we actually got them out into the community. We went to Dundas Station, and we were just there observing, mm-hmm. right? And so, I mean, you'd be so surprised that there were so many people that would be looking around. I mean, looking around for direction.
Yes.
And there was only, I don't want to, hope the TTC doesn't get mad at me, but there was only one staff that was there in the booth on that platform, okay? And this is a busy Saturday.
You must be talking about the northbound side.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep.
Exactly. So well, there was only...
If he goes for a bathroom break...
Yeah, you're screwed, basically. No, sir, that's the reality.
Unless you jump the rail.
Right. So, I mean, so we're looking at that. And again, we're just standing back and we're observing. And so there was one person in particular that that was there. I mean, they were looking around trying to figure out, okay, well, like, you know, where do we go kind of thing.
Yeah.
And they didn't know if they were supposed to go on the northbound or the southbound platform. And then, so I decided to approach that person. Mm-hmm. And then I asked them, you know, so how do you find your TTC experience so far? And they're like, oh, you know, it's pretty good. And then I'm like, okay, well, how about navigating? Are you okay to navigate? Do you guys kind of know where you're going? And they're like, yeah, you know, we're good. We kind of figured out that we need to get over to that side of the platform and all this other stuff. And so for them, that would have been an unarticulated need.
Yes.
They didn't even realize that there was a bit of a pain point here.
Yeah.
I spent maybe 2-3 minutes trying to figure out where I'm supposed to go, right? But when they figured it out, it was no longer a problem.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that right there in terms of signage and navigation, that would have been an unarticulated need. So through observation, you can pick that stuff up, right? But again, this is why you need to kind of have a two-tiered approach, because when we approached them and actually interviewed them, they said that, no, we're good.
Yeah.
But then when we observed them, we saw that pain point there.
Ah, gotcha. So once they found the solution, then in their mind, everything's good.
That's it.
But there would be a level of frustration ahead of time.
Absolutely.
Okay, so you're going to fix the TTC, right?
Well, I mean...
So it actually works.
Well, no, we're trying.
They can get on and building some stuff and stop
this
back and forth craziness. Okay, all right. Okay, so again, I stopped you at articulating.
No, worries.
I can't even get you to finish.
No worries.
Okay, so programs you offer, you go out in the community,
yes.
try this again.
Yes.
And you help with the unarticulated needs. You help to address whatever those particular pain points are that they know or that they may not be aware of.
Right.
Okay. And so what else do you guys do?
So from there now, we actually kind of walk them through the process of ideation. So there's the idea of now that we know what the actual needs are, or mm-hmm. now that we've kind of identified the needs, how do we now generate solutions to actually solve those needs?
Yeah.
So with our program, so what does a program need to incorporate into it to kind of tackle those specific needs that they might have?
Okay.
And then from there, they might either, if we have the expertise in a particular area, then we would work with them to design that. If we don't, then they get a third party partner to work with them, or an expert, subject matter expert, to actually design that part of the curriculum piece.
Okay.
And then they test it out a little bit and then they implement.
Wow. Okay. So some of the services you offer, training as well?
Yeah. So for the organizations that are actually looking to learn the process and not just have us kind of come in. So what I described right there was the consulting. So for an organization that wants to actually learn how do we do this on our own, then we would go in and we have two courses that we offer. One of them being a design thinking course. So how do I basically design a program based on the needs of the people? Mm-hmm. And then the second one being effective facilitation, especially when it comes to young people. Because where we're missing the mark with this one now is that there's a lot of programs for young people, but a lot of the programs are not engaging. A lot of the programs are boring. They're lecture style. They're like school.
You're saying they're boring? Why would you say they're boring?
I mean, that's just the reality of it, man. That's just the reality of it. A lot of these programs that are being run for young people, they lack engagement and interaction. You know what I mean? And immersiveness. So we help them to figure out, okay, how do you use things like project-based learning or you know, getting the youth out there or active or anything like that. How do you use those principles to actually deliver your session to make it more engaging and to actually keep the young people coming back and back and back, right?
I think young folks, well, people in general get bored fairly quickly. And again, we're in a society where everything is, we were talking this earlier, everything is instant.
Yeah.
Instant gratification. Yeah. I want it now. I want it quick. I want it fast. Yes. You know, I'm amazed that Pokemon game has gotten kids out of the house to go and walk around and stuff that. But again, you know, everybody wants everything here now, quick. Mm-hmm. And so, being able to sit in a classroom form, you know, when some of these guys may have been out of school for a couple of years or something like that, and being able to sit in that environment and stay awake.
that's it.
Can be a bit of a challenge. Okay.
No, seriously.
Okay, so you offer consulting services, training, and you were talking about the facilitation.
You got this, man.
Thanks, Matt. Thanks.
So we offer facilitation as well. So we've designed programs internally.
Yeah.
We've designed three of them actually, and so we organizations can kind of hire us on to come in and deliver these trainings for them, or these sessions or programs for them as well.
Okay.
So the three that we've designed are. One called passioneering. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a blend between the word passion and engineering. And the idea behind it is that how do we help young people to identify what they're passionate about? How do we help them to actually, identify what they're passionate about, one. And then how do we help them to use that as a building block to design their future? So that can be in the path of a business or that can be in the path of a career. Right, so we ask them, we kind of help them to go through that bit of a process there, and we help them to actually understand that passion is not something that you're born with. It's something that's kind of unlocked. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I can be, for example, with business, I'm extremely passionate about business, but it wasn't always the case.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe when I was 20, 19 or something like that, I used to want to be a psychology professor. I had no interest in business at all. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I got exposed to it. I was working at a cleaning company. The guy said, you know, Chris, I can either give you a raise to $13 an hour, or if you open up your own little small business, you can, I can give you contracts. I'm like, okay, well, you know, at first I didn't want to do it, but I'm like, I'm 21 or I'm 20 years old. I'm still living at home. What do I have to lose? Kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know? Tried it, got exposed to business, and I loved it. And then from that point, it's like as I kind of got deeper and deeper and deeper into it, the love for it grew. Mm-hmm. You know, same thing as when you're looking at if you're attracted to somebody, starts off as an attraction first, and then as you get to know the person and kind of go deeper and deeper and deeper into it, love hopefully blossoms. You know what I'm saying? Something like that. So you've been told. But then on the other one, now we also offer like something that we call innovation and creativity.
Yeah.
That's kind of like the design thinking program. So the whole idea with that one is that the workforce is changing. right? A lot of things now are moving towards automation, or they're moving towards being outsourced.
Yes.
And what we're not doing is we're not preparing young people for that new workforce where employers want people who have 21st century skills. Mm-hmm. So that can look like critical thinking, creativity, problem solving, entrepreneurial, collaboration, all of those skills that young people are not being trained on that employers need. Mm-hmm. We in this program, we actually get them out into the community and engage and actually try to solve a real world problem through this design thinking process. So the same way that we work with organizations to design programs, mm-hmm. we train them on that and we pair them up with an organization to solve that challenge. Right. So again, they're gaining that confidence by going out there and pitching it to the executive board, all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And the last program that we have is it's called an entrepreneur's mindset. So it's this idea of not necessarily trying to create entrepreneurs with this program, but how do we help them to adopt the mindset of an entrepreneur? Because the reality is, and I'm sure you can attest to this as well, mm-hmm. Is that entrepreneurs have a particular mindset, right? Mm-hmm. So they're taking an idea from absolutely nothing tangible,
yes,
and creating something physical, tangible that people can experience, right? Mm-hmm. You need a certain set of qualities and characteristics to do that. So how do we help these young people to adopt that mindset? Even if they don't want to pursue entrepreneurship, how do we help them to adopt that mindset, right?
Okay, so
I love it. I love when you do that
thing. It is a bit of a challenge because yes. Our society kind of tries to make everybody, you know, a cog in a wheel. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, and so mm-hmm. to break out of that, yeah. And which is so weird because, you know, back in the day, you worked for a company for, yeah. you know, 40 years, yep, yep, and then anymore. You retire and yep. try to live on half of what you were making when you were working for them for 40 years.
Yeah.
And, yep. But now it's like most people find that they're switching careers every mm-hmm. I don't know, 5 years, 10 years, yeah. or something like that.
Yep.
You know, they get you get right size, down size, however mm-hmm. size you want to call it. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. and then you got to reinvent yourself in a way. Yes. So yes. that critical thinking is becoming obviously more and more of an asset.
Absolutely.
In the workforce environment going forward.
Yes.
But there's still a lot of individuals who are being pushed mm-hmm. into being that cog in a wheel. Mm-hmm. So society sort of, you know, wants you to be that cog in the wheel mm-hmm. to some degree. But then the reality is you need that critical thinking. You need a lot of those entrepreneurial skills yeah. even to be an employee of most of the major organizations Absolutely. That are out there, which is kind of weird because if you're an entrepreneur, then you'd be you working for yourself.
Yeah, you know? Right, right.
But
right.
So how do you help people to shift that thing? Because, you know, you go home and then you know, your parents might be, get a job, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. Go to school, get your education, come out, you get a job, you yeah. work, you know, and that, because that's their mindset and that's right, what they've lived through.
Right.
So how do you help a young person to make that leap yeah. from... like I think you were saying earlier before we started about the whole smartphone versus mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. you know yeah. phone booth, or if yeah. anybody doesn't know what a phone booth is, I'm sorry.
Before your time.
Being able to shift that mentality.
Right.
Because our society today says you need to be a smartphone.
Yeah.
And you need to be a smartphone actually that's not even invented yet.
Right. Right.
So how do you do that?
So okay, so one, we tackle young people first and foremost. Because we think the adults, they're it's too late for them. I'm kidding. Oh, I'm wow. playing. I'm playing. I'm playing. I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
Well, I think you're right though, because there are a lot of older folks. They're set in their ways, and that's it.
Absolutely.
Nothing's changing. It's stone now.
Absolutely.
And concrete.
So, I mean, and that's something I heard as well growing up. My parents would always tell me, you know, okay, go to school, get a job, and you know, kind of live happily ever after, right?
Yes.
But for us, what we do with these young people is just we're trying to get them to adopt the qualities. So we're not saying that you have to go out there and start your own thing, because the reality is that's not for everybody, right? Mm-hmm. So we're not saying you have to necessarily go out there and start your own thing, but adopt the mindset. You don't have to be creative. You don't have to be an entrepreneur to be creative. Mm-hmm. You don't have to be an entrepreneur to take risks. You don't have to be an entrepreneur to be a problem solver, right? Mm-hmm. So it's how do you take these qualities and make them transferable to the path that you want to go on, mm-hmm. right? I mean, eventually, I'm sure there's going to come a time where the way we see work, it doesn't exist. So the 9-to-5 job, it won't exist. Mm-hmm. You know, even the schools won't exist either. I mean, do you mind if I kind of go into
this a little bit?
Because you got me started right now, man. So
let's work
so,
it out.
So here's my thing. Here's my thing. I believe that there's a time where the way that we have school today is not going to exist.
Yeah.
And the reason why I say that is because if you look at the way schools are designed, it's designed to create an employee mindset,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So it's designed to prepare you for the workforce. And I don't care what anybody tells me, that's what it is. That's just the reality of it, right? Mm-hmm. So because it was created during the time of the Industrial Revolution, all that kind of stuff. And so they needed to create workers. And so they kind of crafted the curriculum and all that kind of stuff from like 1800s to now. And it's the same thing till today, right? Mm-hmm. But the workforce now is changing. And so school is having that, you know, that shift. Like, it's slowly shifting, in a sense, to prepare them for the workforce. But I believe that there's going to come a time where schools, the way we see it today, it's not going to exist. Because what's going to happen is, if you kind of look back to with ancient Egypt, mm-hmm. So back in ancient Egypt, about 5,000 years ago, they didn't have the schools like how we have schools today, okay? And you got to keep in mind that these people created the concept of math. Mm-hmm. They created the concept of the 24-hour clock. Mm-hmm. They created the concept of the 365-day calendar. And this is still stuff we're using 5,000 years later.
Yeah.
So they created these I call them building blocks for civilizations for years to come, mm-hmm. right? And so the idea is that the way that they educated their young people or their kids or whatever was from 0 to 6, they were with the mother, mm-hmm. right? No matter if it was a boy or girl. From 0 to 6, they were being nurtured under the mother. And then from 7 onward, if it was a boy, they would start apprenticing with the father. And mm-hmm. this is from 7 years old, okay? They would start apprenticing with the father. So what we see, or what I see actually, I should say, is there's going to come a time where schools are replaced by these things, these incubators of sorts,
yes.
right? Because there's a, if you look at school, or if you look at the current system, we went from creating an employee mindset, and mm-hmm. then we started to shift towards now where it's like more of an entrepreneur's mindset. That's like a buzzword now, right?
Yeah.
Then we're moving to actually to a designer's mindset. That's really becoming a popular thing now, especially in schools.
Mm-hmm.
How do you adopt the mindset of a designer? But what I believe is going to happen is that we're going to start preparing people to adopt an innovator's mindset. And these mm-hmm. innovators are the people that create these industries. So for example, the guy that created the concept of the elevator,
mm-hmm.
right? Before that idea came about, the buildings that were only about 4 to 5 floors high,
yeah,
right, and the top floor was the cheapest floor,
yeah,
because no one wanted to have to walk up, right?
Okay,
and so only the poor people live at the top floor, and then the rich people would be at the bottom floor, right? Because it's the easiest one accessible,
yeah.
right? So, and that was the idea. So now, when you come up with the concept of the elevator, Elijah Otis, when he came up with this idea for the elevator. Completely revolutionized
yes.
the industry. He created an entirely new industry where now they can build skyscrapers. They can now the top floor is now the penthouse, and that's yeah. the most expensive, right? So I believe that there's going to come a time where we're going to be nurturing young people from when they're born to follow a particular stream in their life, and then that's going to allow them to become like these innovators, these people that think way outside of the box.
Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying? And I'll give you another example of that. Because when you look at a lot of the successful people that we have in our time right now, a lot of them, their life was kind of streamlined. So from when they were young, they were exposed to the same thing that they became successful in. So mm-hmm. for example, Bill Gates, when he was like, I think it was maybe in grade 7 or 8, he got exposed to computers. Mm-hmm. And now what was he known for?
Mm-hmm.
Computer programs, right? So, same thing with a guy by the name of Warren Buffett. He was exposed to stocks, investments when he was young. What is he known for? Stocks and investments. That's what he garnered his wealth in.
Mm-hmm.
Beyonce, what is she known for? Singing. When she was young, she used to sing. And she followed this particular path all the way through life,
mm-hmm.
right? And became successful in that. Same thing with Henry Ford. He used to love to tinker with things when he was young. Same process.
Mm-hmm.
Same process. So I believe there's going to come a time where that's what we nurture. We nurture that natural inclination that a child might have. And then that's what they will follow along with until they're older. That's how you'd be able to garner this insight. Look at the people in the Olympics,
mm-hmm.
those athletes in the Olympics. You'll never hear a story where they just started a couple years ago. It was always from when they were young.
Mm-hmm.
They were exposed to from when they were young, and they kind of followed through, and now they're competing on the world stage, right? It's this idea of that.
I completely agree with you in regards to that, but there's also a bit of a challenge between how do you understand or figure out what your child's is geared towards
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
versus what you think.
Right.
You know, because there are a lot of individuals who go through college and university and they yeah. spend a gazillion dollars because yeah. their parents wanted them to be an accountant.
Yeah.
I used to talk to lots of people like this all the time. Right. You know, right. Their dads wanted them to be an accountant. So mm-hmm. they went through, they spent all this money, they became an accountant. They're like working in a call center mm-hmm. because they don't want to have anything to do with accounting. Mm-hmm. you know,
yeah, no, that's really
And there are a lot of individuals who go through life when they get these degrees, they yeah. get these things because, right. you know, of outside pressure,
right.
because that's Absolutely. The path that they're supposed to go. But Absolutely. Deep inside, it's not really what they wanted.
Right.
Right. So when we look at all these pressures mm-hmm. and then you look at the individual to be able to figure out, you know, what path, how do you nurture that mind
right.
to be able to get to whatever it is that they want or right. be able to figure out what that would be,
right.
you know, who the next quote unquote Bill Gates is going to be or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
When you're looking at, you know, 2-3 year old
mm-hmm.
or even some of the folks who come into your program, they yeah. you might ask them, you know, what are you passionate about? I don't know. Because they've never really been thinking that way.
Right, right.
So how do you pull that out of them to be able to get them to see, oh, you know what? Maybe you are an artist. Maybe yeah. you can draw. Maybe you can sing. Maybe you can, I don't know, have a propensity for business.
Right, right.
You know, your name should be on the side of the building.
Right, right. No.
How do you pull that out of them when the mindset up until that point has been, well, my mom wanted me to do this or my dad wanted me to do that, so that's what I've been focused on.
Right.
And then how do you handle the parents coming at you saying, why are you telling me pitney fee?
I know.
Drop out of school.
I know. So actually, there's a couple of things that you said in there. One of them being, so this with this new, and I guess my vision for education, I don't see it happening right now, right?
Okay.
And there's going to need to be some type
so
of
So parents, you're safe for now.
Yeah, for now. For now. But I don't see it happening right now. I mean, I think it's something that's going to happen gradually as we kind of go along. Mm-hmm. And I think that what's going to happen eventually is that, I don't know, but you might have like these researchers that are going to be coming in, or your child goes to this institution or whatever, or incubator, and then they let the child play. They yeah. let the child do what they naturally do, right? Mm-hmm. And then the people who are kind of there will be able to identify specific indicators. So this child loves to draw.
Yeah.
Right. Or this child loves to sing. This child loves to be in public and making people laugh. I don't know, whatever the case yeah. might be. So I can see that, you know, that kind of being the process that happens later on. Not a prophet. I don't know if it's going to happen like that, but that's kind of what I see, at least in terms of the young people that we work with now.
Yeah.
You'll be surprised that all I really ask them is, what were you naturally gravitated towards when you were younger? What did you love to do before someone told you what to do? What did you naturally gravitate towards? Mm-hmm. What did you do that was where that was the that intrinsic motivation? That thing that you did naturally, mm-hmm. right? That's what I would ask them. And then I would ask them, what happened to that? What happened to that? I mean, was it you went into school or you went somewhere and you were told, no, well, you need to kind of follow this particular path,
mm-hmm.
right? Because I believe that everybody has something when they were younger that they naturally gravitated towards. I believe that. You might not remember what it was, yeah. but I believe that everybody has something. For me, it was my curiosity. I was an extremely curious child. I mean, I remember there was a time where my uncle used to walk me to school. And it should have only taken us about maybe 10 to 15 minutes to get to school, but it would actually take us 45 to 60 minutes because I would stop and ask questions and touch things about everything I encountered. Uncle, why is this can red? Uncle, why is that toad making that sound? Like all these, I would ask all these different things. Mm-hmm. And that curiosity is what really drives the success of my business today. Really.
Yeah, I keep going back to our society
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
because like for the most part, the kids, they get driven to school.
Yeah. Yeah. No, true.
They,
true.
They're playing video games. Mm-hmm. Like they barely go outside. They don't, you know, get to see a toad or touch a frog or catch Absolutely. A tadpole or,
Absolutely.
You know, all that sort of stuff. We live in such a sterile environment.
Yes. Yes.
In yes. that, whether it be germs yeah. or, yeah. you know, everything.
Yeah.
So looking at a child and saying, okay, what are those natural things? Where yeah. there's such a big wide world out there that yeah. they've never really truly been exposed to.
Absolutely.
You know, for me
mm-hmm.
as a parent, I think that, you know, if that's the environment you're raising a child, then you're doing a huge disservice
Absolutely.
To the child because there's
Absolutely.
So much out there. I know there's lots of germs and lots of stuff that's out there, but mm-hmm. let's help their immune system a little bit, get
right.
used to these things.
Right. No,
you
true,
know what
it's
I mean?
True. It's true.
So, yeah, so when you're looking at these kids
yeah.
who are now, what, 19, 20 years old,
yeah.
right? who are coming to your program and they've been in, my 12-year-old would say, bubble wrapped.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and yeah. He's 12 and he's saying
he's,
that.
He's see, saying that. That. Wow. Not about him. He's no, like, he talks about his friends. Talks about his friends all the time.
Bubble wrapped society.
I'd be like, you know, does buddy such and such want to, you know, you guys want to go to the park or something? Oh, no, his mom bubble wraps him. He can't go anywhere. I'm like, what? He's like, can't go anywhere outside. I'm like, what do you mean he can't? He's 12 years old. He can't go outside and play. Like, what happened to the good old days? You'd go ride your bike or chase a frog or something. Right, I don't know.
Right,
you know.
Right.
So these kids now are 20, mm-hmm. 19, 20, and they've lived in this bubble wrapped environment wherein their parents kind of did everything.
Yeah.
I used to manage, and I had a kid who was 22 years old, 23 mm-hmm. years old, who was. I did his review
mm-hmm.
at work,
mm-hmm.
and he didn't get the type of review that he thought he should get. And his mm-hmm. parents were calling me. Wow. His parents was calling me, his boss, to complain the fact that I didn't give him the review that he wanted to mm-hmm. give to he wanted to get. And mm-hmm. I was kind of like, "You don't work for this company." But this is the mindset, the, right? That a lot of people grow their kids up with,
yes.
right?
Yes.
Especially now, kids are staying longer at home. Mm-hmm. You know, all sort of stuff. So, mm-hmm. you know, kudos to you to have to put up with this, but how do you deal with that
kind
of get them say go outside, go play with some frogs for a bit and come back? Like,
I hear you. Well, again, we don't work with at that.
I know that's a really long speech I just gave. But.
No, but it's important, man. So with the young people that we work with, it's exploration.
Yeah.
Like, I am a huge proponent of exploration because that's how you get exposed to things you never even knew existed. You know what I mean? So for example, when you look at Einstein, I think it was his dad that gave him a compass. And then that compass was what kind of sparked this curiosity of how is this thing working? Mm-hmm. How was it, you know, how was the little needle thing propelled above whatever it was? I'm not a scientist, you know what I mean? But how was it propelled above that? So it's like this idea of when we get them out there and exposing them to things, like it helps to kind of further those connections that they have going on in their brain. You know what I mean? Just exploring and seeing things, touching things, going to museums, going abroad. Mm-hmm. You know, showing them a different perspective on life, like all that kind of stuff.
You need to do that in the States a little bit.
I know, right?
We won't get into that. What's going on in the south of the 49 parallel.
Right. But you know what I find interesting, though? Just because you touched on it, actually. And I really feel like the mindset that we currently have today, a lot of it is manufactured.
Yeah.
A lot of it is manufactured. It was intentional. Somebody wanted us to think a certain way, or people wanted us to think a certain way. I'm not talking conspiracy here, but people wanted us to think a certain way.
It's the government.
and they wanted us, I mean, when you think about it, like the values that we have, so the value that we place on money,
yes.
the value that we place on a degree, the value that we place on things that don't actually have any intrinsic value. Mm-hmm. Like somebody said that I want you to value this, so I'm going to create an environment for you to grow up and value that.
Well, okay, so
the question I would ask you, Patrick, the question I would ask you is, what did you value before you were told what to value? Or who, or did you know who you were before you were told who you need to be?
Me? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you.
I know who I am. I've been knowing that for a long time.
Amazing. One of the few, man. One of the few.
Yeah, and it's a scary thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because I talk to, you know, grown people, and they're still trying to figure out stuff. And I'm like,
absolutely.
I'm like, if you were 20 years old, that would probably be okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But you're like 40.
That's it.
I'm like, you live more than half your life already.
That's it.
You got some problems.
Seriously. No, and it's funny because we were running that passioneering program with a group of people who had like PhDs, masters, and all these mm-hmm. these high level educators. And we ran that passioneering program, and it was so sad to hear that a lot of them didn't know their strengths. They could tell you the ins and outs of astronomy or the ins and outs of psychology, but a lot of them didn't know who they are. And I mean, if you can raise a generation to feel like it's more valuable for you to know what's going on around the world than it is to know about yourself, there's a problem there, man.
Mm-hmm.
There's a huge problem there. And that's what we have. People with PhDs have no clue what their purpose is, no clue what they're passionate about.
Okay, so our society is set up in, you know, in such a way that we're told what music to listen to.
Yeah.
We're told, you know, what clothes we're supposed to wear each Absolutely. Season. What colors the in color.
Yeah.
You know, we're told what things to watch on TV.
Yes.
We're told what food to buy. Mm-hmm. We're also told what medications to buy to combat the disease we get from the food we were told to eat. You know, we were told what other medications to get to combat the side effects of the medication
yeah.
that we are taking for the bad food we're eating. Like, yeah, you know, we're so kind of programmed.
Absolutely.
In so many different ways.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I know I sound like a conspiracy theorist kind of guy here for a second.
But I mean, it's the truth,
but
man.
We are programmed, you know, this way. And so for kids growing up, living in a household that their parents are kind of programmed that way, and now they're going out in society and trying to function in this world, that it's such a counter culture because on one hand, you're kind of being programmed to be a certain way, live a certain way. But then when you get out in the real world and you start looking for work and you start getting in, then you realize, well, hold on a second. Maybe that may not be the right best way for me to live my life.
Absolutely.
You know, and then you're sort of stuck in this almost no man's land of trying to figure out, because a lot of people grow up not thinking about who I am, what am I about, and what it is that I'm putting out in the universe.
Yes.
Most people are programmed to just, you know, be receptive, be consumers. Mm-hmm. It's not about creating. It's not about building. It's more about consuming.
Right.
So that I could tell you something, you know, that you're going to consume.
Right.
Right. So all these kids coming into this program thinking like that, and then you've got parents kind of, you know, how do you deal with the parents? Like the parents come on board and say, okay, I realize, you know, my kid just spent 2 years to become an accountant and he doesn't want to be an accountant anymore. And, you know, your program's helping him to figure out that he needs to stand up to me to say he's not going to be an accountant.
No, I hear what you're saying. So the good part is that because we don't actually run the program independently, we don't have that problem.
Okay.
But the organizations that host the program, they might have that problem.
I'm just kidding. School board's fault now.
Yeah. But I mean, the good part is that there's a huge, because there's like a huge shift towards passion nowadays, there are a lot of parents who are actually on board that want their kid to kind of pursue what they're passionate about. Okay. I mean, you still have some that are more of the traditional mindset.
Yeah.
But even when I speak to parents, a lot of them will say, even like you know, they want their kid to pursue what they're passionate about.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That is, you know, becoming more of a popular thing. And again, I think that's because that's what people are also being fed. You know, there's a huge push for that.
All right, let's talk about, we've been talking about a lot of stuff here, but in terms of your organization, you know, what do you need? Do you need workers? Do you need money? Do you need volunteers? Mm-hmm. Are you looking to hire? Are you, how do people get involved? How does this work for you?
Yeah. So there's a couple of things that we need. Money. If you're an investor out there and you're looking to invest, or if you just want to give us a grant or you want to donate, holler at me.
Money is always good. Anybody want to give me money, I'll take some. As long as there's no strings attached.
Yeah, I know, right? Exactly. So, one of the things that we're looking to do right now is actually hire 3 young people. We're looking for a designer, a graphic designer. We're also looking for 2 brand ambassadors as well.
Okay.
And we specifically want to hire from, and you know, you can say whatever you want, but we're specifically want to hire from either Jane and Finch or Rexdale.
Jaden Finch or Rexdale.
Yeah.
So if I live in Markham, that means that I'm not eligible.
No, not right now.
Why?
Well, you know why?
You're discriminating against me because I live in Markham.
Say whatever you want. You know, but the reason why is because a lot of the young people in these neighborhoods face multiple barriers to employment. Mm-hmm. Right? They face multiple barriers to employment. I was talking to an employment counselor actually, and he had told me that when he's speaking to some employers, because they have there's a job program or something happening right now.
Yeah.
When he speaks to some employers, he asked that sometimes they have to actually change the address on the young person's resume just for the employer to actually take a look at the resume.
Really?
And that's real life. And this is coming from an employment counselor dealing with this stuff day in and day out. Right. So, I mean, when you look at something like that, and then, I mean, even down to names where employers will look over certain names.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, this is real life. And so, I mean, when you
have. So they have to change your name to Bob.
No, I mean, well, they don't change
Bob
the name.
Smith.
They don't change the name. I don't think, at least. But but I mean, there's multiple barriers to employment. You know, there's multiple barriers for some of these young people. And so we want to go into those communities and we want to actually hire them. And my thing is that because we're working in these communities so heavily, why not employ the people that are from those communities, who have a better sense as to what's going on in those communities and are well connected in those communities? Why not employ them than bringing somebody from, you know, God knows where, and trying to bring them into that community and say, we have the solution.
But I might. Understand what's going on in Jane and Finch.
Yeah, but it goes back to the idea of experience. You cannot. No, I mean, the person who understands most is the person that has experienced something.
I got
right? you. You know what I mean?
Understand. Okay, and so they don't have to change their address. They don't have to change their address on their resume to you.
No, they don't.
And they don't have to change their name to Bob Smith. And they're sending absolutely it to you. Not. Okay. So how do they get their resumes to you?
That's actually a really good question, because we don't accept resumes.
Oh.
So we're one of those employers that are really moving away from a lot of traditional stuff.
Okay.
So for example, we don't accept resumes. What we want is an online video profile. Yeah, an online video profile. So
is that what I'm going to have to start doing? If I'm looking for a job, I need to
It will be.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, seriously. A lot of resumes are going out, man. That's old school, man. That's primitive. Primitive, man.
Okay, all right.
So they'll send us a link to their online video profile.
All right.
And that could talk about things like, you know, what they're passionate about, maybe some of the experience that they might have had, all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And then from there, we'll select a candidate, and then we'll bring them to a... we actually take them out for dinner.
Oh.
We take them out for dinner.
You take them out for dinner?
Yeah, we take them out for
dinner.
I mean, no, hold on, let me clarify. we take them out for appetizers. Okay? Okay. We take them out for appetizers on St. Louis, like 50% off appetizers.
Oh, is that what...
So
we was just gonna say, let's go to Barbarian Steakhouse, man. Let's make that happen.
No. So we take them out for appetizers, and the reason why we do that is because we want to see if they're gonna be a cultural fit.
Okay.
We want to be able to determine how are you in a social setting? How are you when we're just interacting, like, you know, one on one or with my team? Mm-hmm. How are you? Like, what kind of things are you gonna say? What's your demeanor like? Because that stuff is really important.
Okay.
It's extremely important, right? And then from there, we determine if you're hired or not.
Okay, so no resumes are to be sent to you.
Yeah.
You want a video profile.
Yes.
Okay, so on your website, does it list these openings and tell people what they need to say in their profile?
Yeah. So we actually have, if you go to workable.inspiredinitiatives.com, or it might be the other way. No, inspiredinitiatives.workable.com. Sorry.
Okay.
If you go to that link, you'll see, you know, full job description profiles and all that kind of stuff. And for the video profiles if you don't know how to do the video profiles, we also have a link in the job description for you to kind of go and research. And I mean, we're not asking you to go and hire, you know,
a videographer.
Right. We're not asking for all that. Like, we don't mind camera quality stuff. Yeah. We just want to know that. We want to know you.
So they can, like, record it with their cell phone type thing and then send that in.
If you want to Snapchat it, go ahead. It's up to you, man. You know, it's up to you.
Okay, so they can go onto your website.
Yeah.
Which is in
inspiredinitiatives.com.
Okay.
Plug in.
So if they from there they'll be able to access your
the job listings and stuff.
Thank you. I can't even talk right now.
Yeah, no worries.
The job listings. There you go.
I should take your job. I'm playing.
It doesn't pay much, I'm telling you. trying to get Jason to give me some money, but you see, he's not even smiling.
He doesn't look impressed right now.
He's hiding under his hat right now. So people can go to your website. They can, is there a particular age range that you're looking for?
Well, we want young people. But
I'm young.
And we don't mind the young at heart either.
I didn't say I was young at heart. I said
What's
the age range, man?
I'd probably say 18 to 24.
18 to 24.
Yeah, 18 to
24. Okay. 24. So between the age of 18 to 24, if you've got a child that fits that criteria, 18 to 24, who has an outgoing personality, who's friendly, who can work with other people, and is likable.
Yes.
Right? And then by all means, go to the Inspired Initiative website and have them submit their video profile.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just thinking, like, I'm gonna have to start doing a video profile.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what people often have is they have a video profile, and then depending on the job,
LinkedIn is not it anymore.
No, I mean no. I mean it's okay for some employers, but not always.
It's interesting.
Not always. And it's funny. It's interesting actually. So if there's any young people out there listening, just to let you know that if you are applying for a job, please note that employers do look at your social media presence. They do. So if you have stuff on your social media that where you got plastered the night before or something like that, put it on private or take it down, because employers are looking at your social media profile. That is a promise. They do that every single day. I'm telling you, man. All right. So just wanted to send that public service announcement out there.
Oh, there you go. Okay. So be careful of what you're posting.
Seriously.
On a real tip, that stuff never goes away.
It doesn't.
You might think that you deleted those photos from Instagram or Facebook or whatever, but they're still there.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, that's good word to the wise, period. Okay, we got like 3 minutes left. This hour flew by. Told you it was going to go by quick.
That's true.
So people can contact you by going to your website.
Yes.
If people want to throw money at you, they can also do that at the website. Hopefully, kinds that fold, not the kind that hurts. Or send it by e-transfer or whatever.
Ah, you got it.
And so what's coming up? Anything coming up for you guys?
Yeah.
Next little while?
We actually have a lot of things.
Like school starting, and you got like 3 minutes to say this, right?
Okay, so
starting shortly.
So there's a couple of things happening, actually. So we talked about the bit of a hiring fair that we're doing. We also have a lot of... So our whole thing is that we're bringing project-based learning into the schools and into the curriculum as well. Mm-hmm. So we're doing a lot of work with the Ministry of Education to incorporate things like design thinking and innovation and creativity into the actual classroom. So okay. We're getting kids out of the classroom, putting them into like these... in some cases into a barn, and we're getting them to solve problems for, you know, organizations and all that great stuff. So we have that happening on the school front. We're also doing some work over in Pakistan, where we're building
in
Pakistan.
What?
Yeah, doing some work over in Pakistan.
Can I come on that trip?
Maybe we'll see. We're doing some work over in Pakistan where we're working with an organization down there to build almost like a youth center.
Okay.
And have a lot of different programs running through that youth center. We're also working on, we're going to be joining a team of, educators to build a school over in Cambodia, actually. And our plan is that we want to be the almost like the innovation department type thing, mm-hmm. Where we're going to be having a lot of curriculum, a lot of work and content related to that space there. I don't know. Do I have more time left?
Damn, you got a whole lot going on.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot, man. There's a lot of things. A lot of things that we're working on right now.
All right. I think we got like another minute or so. Jason's
one last
giving me the cue.
Okay. Well, I guess if there was one last thing I want to share with everybody is that it's this idea of, you know, you're built like a payphone. You are designed to be a smartphone. I'm sorry. You're designed to be a smartphone. Don't live like a payphone. Don't live like a payphone. And if you know what a payphone is, you'll know that a payphone operates at the most very most basic level. The very most basic level. They only make phone calls, right? If you're designed like a payphone, or if you're designed like a smartphone, the idea is that you have so much more potential that you can tap into. So tap into that. Please, for the love of God, tap into that. That's my spiel.
Chris, it's definitely been a pleasure having you on the show today.
Thank you very much for having me on.
I'm glad that you're doing what you're doing, because it's definitely something that's important within the community. This is not just a Black thing. This is, you know, newcomers, just anybody who lives in an area that is marginalized.
Yeah.
So definitely thank you for being here on the show. Those of you at home, thank you for listening. And enjoy the rest of your Sunday afternoon. It looks like it's going to be a nice day.
Nice.
Oh, wait. I got more time? I got 30 seconds.
We got 30 seconds.
So what's your website again?
www.inspiredinitiatives.com. We also have Twitter @inspired_II. Facebook is facebook.com/inspiredinitiativesTO.
Great. And for those who are watching, you see this hat that I'm wearing? It's available on the iLive store. So you can buy the hat and along with other paraphernalia for iLive. You can walk around and advertise for us and let people know that we exist and what we're doing and all the great music that you're listening to.
Yes.
So I think that's 30 seconds. We're good? We're good. All right. Thank you, everybody.
All right.
Take care.
1st internet radio station around. iLife Radio, the new social network.
I said that I love you so, and I mean it so. From the bottom of my heart, I'm telling you to play. Baby, I saw that something in your eyes. Comes to no surprise that you turned me oh so giddy.
What's up, people? This is Omar, and you're listening to iLive Radio, changing the way you listen to radio.
Rare groove, revival, slow jams, upfront, old school.
The best music around in stereo, stereo, stereo sound.
Music back to back to back.
iLive Radio.
How you doing? What's good? It's Nkechi the Lyrical, sitting in my zone here, vibing and listening to iLive. And if you don't know, get to know. And if you do know, you don't know. And if you know, then relax and enjoy the ride.
This is Sharisha from The Spot. Catch me every Sunday, 5 to 7 p.m. EST, playing the very best in neo-soul, jazz, underground hip-hop, art, music, poetry, and community, right here on iLive Radio.
You're listening to iLive Radio, changing the way you listen to radio. iLive Radio.
The soul expression show.
Good afternoon, good evening, welcome to Soul Expressions. Streaming across the world wide web. Don't forget you can catch Patrick Morris same time, same place next week. Very cloudy Sunday afternoon. Going to cheer up your soul with some classic soul music.
Time I ever saw you.
And a brand new section called The Magnificent Sevens.
That's just what it was.
Right now.
Then passion got bold and whispered.
sounds of Evelyn Champagne King.
Sweet love is here.
We're streaming live on Facebook Live for the first time also. Yeah. Gotta hold my stomach in, innit? Someone said, is that a belly I see? Yes, I want 46 in it, we expect. So don't forget, spread the word, share the link. Soul Expressions right here on iLive Radio. Trying to see how this thing works. Good evening, Sims Mode. Good evening, Rico. What's going on, brother? Massive shouts out to Mrs. Slacker the Beat Child. Big shouts out to my boxing trainer, Yvette. Sounds of Jermaine Jackson. We'll be right back. taken from the Jermaine LP. This is Beautiful Morning. About 15 minutes. Studio line will be open. If you're in Toronto, 647-243-9379 gets you through. If you're in the UK, 02-03-223-9374. Got to figure out a way of how to feed the live feed directly into this phone, you know. Trust me. Anyway, moving to the sounds of Brainstorm. This one goes out to Gary Taylor, aka Gazza, who was in earlier. Each and every Sunday, always digging. If you like your music eclectic, make sure you tune into that show.
You
Big shouts out to Skylar Maynard.
Expression Show with DJ Sessions.
So we'd just like to say a very, very, very big thank you to everyone that came down to the family day yesterday. That was some kind of day, that storm that came over the top. Oh my God. I thought it was going to take out the whole thing, bruv. Like, it's really bad. Yeah, pictures will be posted of the storm that came over the top of that. Like, unbelievable. It was water coming in everywhere and it shorted out the electricity that we had and everything went down. But, you know, eventually the sun came out and everyone that was down there had a great time. Big shouts out to the group that was next to us. Legends playing flag football during the storm. I don't understand what was going on. There was lightning imminent and they were just stinking. They were playing in the rain. So big shouts out to you as well. So it was cool. It was cool. We thought about cancelling it, but you know what? We thought we'd go for it and we were glad that we did. Thank you to everyone that came down and supported Family Day, and look out for our next one next year. So let's get into some more music. This is Sounds of Mr. Leroy Hudson. Sounds of Mr. Leroy Hudson, released on a Curtain label, owned by Mr. Curtis Mayfield and Love's Holiday. Let's move on to the sound of a wonderful, wonderful artist, Miss Betty Wright. You're tuning to Soul Expressions right here on iLive Radio. Betty, shouts out to Remster, just joined. Congratulations on the nuptials. Sounds like Miss Betty Wright. Keep your loving, keep your loving, keep your loving. The classic, keep love new.